So I've actually got an iBeacon attached to my cat.
Ruby is alive. Ruby's not going anywhere.
Oh, I want to dream for developer happiness.
Thank you, thank you. No worries, I brought the map to the wasteland, so no worries. Let's start talking about Ruby. Ruby's old, and its standard library is very big. A big standard library is something important for a language to have, because it's kind of obvious. No one will care how beautiful, fast is your language if you cannot do useful things with it in a standard way, out of the box. Ruby understood this from the very beginning, and it has a very big standard library to do basically everything. That was a big contributor to the first wave of adoption of Ruby, as Ben told before. Rails probably was the main contributor to that second wave, but still it was important in the beginning. Now, having a big standard library is not all nice and good and wine and roses. It's mainly a lot of work. It's work not only creating it, which is already a lot of work, but maintaining it. Maintaining it doesn't only mean fixing bugs, but also keeping the documentation up to date, making sure everything is backwards compatible to some extent. It's a lot of work. And also the APIs of the standard library are difficult to evolve, because changes break code and no one likes their code broken. So as a result, more than 20 years later, the standard library has not aged very well. Someone described it as a wasteland before. I won't deny that. I would just try to map that wasteland. As I said, the Ruby standard library has not aged well. It's unpopular. Many people don't like it. In some cases, it's very unpopular, and people get angry at it. And its parts have received like varied amounts of love and care. It's a very big code base. It's a very big code base with different levels of quality and usefulness and care. Summarized that quality as love. Also, different levels of fame. There are parts which are more widely known, and there are parts that are more obscure. For example, there are some libraries that somehow made the cut, and they are okay. They work well. Everybody use them. CSV, JSON, Logger, Benchmark, OpenStruct, you name it. There are a lot of examples. There are also some others that are basically forgotten. They are legacy. They are there, but I don't think most people use them. Many people don't know about them. They are just there, sitting in your laptops without you knowing. They are there, no harm, also no use. There are also some parts that, for some reason or other, are widely known. In some cases, use it, but they are not great, and I think that's the source of much of the hate that you get into the standard library. And there is also some other area in which I'd like to focus on this talk of things that are in the standard library that they are okay. I find them useful, and I find that they are not very very well known. So I will try to make a short trip through the wasteland. To see if we find some hidden jewel around. So let's go with our first example, NetHTP. It's a joke. NetHTP is a very good example of why it is important to have a good standard library, but also a good example of what can go wrong. How can a library age badly and not evolve Yeah, NHTTP is a good example of it. It's also very unpopular. While I was preparing this talk, I read this tweet by Abdigrim about HTTP clients. I thought, oh, this is exactly what I'm working on. So I will keep track of this poll that he was organizing. He defined the library as wonky, which is a word that I didn't know by then, but I looked it up. It's a pretty accurate description of the state of that library. It's buggy, it's slow, it's not very feature-rich. There are many things missing that you need to do by yourself, and the API is very confusing. It's not consistent, and yeah, I think everybody can relate to the experience of having to look it up every time you use it because you don't remember the order of the parameters or the name of a method. Yeah, it's a summary, no one likes it. As a result, this is the list that Abdi compiled for his poll. There are at least four or maybe more alternatives. They are all widely used. None of them is a clear winner. Basically any big Rails application, I think, depends on two or three of them because of transitive dependencies. I think that's a bit sad state of things. On top of that, NetHTTP keeps being used because some people, even if they don't like it, don't want to make this situation worse. I find this comment like it reflects what I think. I also don't like NetHTTP, but I don't like when I do some open source to force my favorite HTTP library into anyone through a dependency because of that. That situation is bad. So. Yeah, everybody loses. The state of HTTP in Ruby is bad and it's sad. And it's probably a lost case and we have to live with it. But I think there are some other examples which are not lost cases and that being known and used by the people will help keep them alive. So now for real, let's go with those five examples I want to tell you about today to see if we can learn something useful. The first one is called Set. Maybe many of you know it, but if you don't, it's a very useful one, and I hope that you go home with something new to use. We all learn about sets in school, and then unless we study math, we forget about it. In programming, everything is lists or arrays, as we call them in Ruby, or dictionaries or hashes, as we call them in Ruby. But there is also the set. A set is a container of things, pretty similar to an array, because it has a common with it. There are some exceptions, things that are different in a set than in an array. It doesn't keep the order of the things you put in it, unlike an array. It doesn't support duplicates. You cannot add the same thing twice to a set. It's either there or it's not. It also has a very nice property, which is it's very fast at finding elements on it. These characteristics are interesting because the two first sometimes don't matter. Even sometimes it's something that is nice. The third one is nice always. I like fast. So basically, if you in your code you are calling include on an array very often, or also unique, you're probably seeing an array that wants to be a set. You should be using a set. Look at this example. You have probably written or read code similar to this. It is a list of IPs. And I write a method to check whether it's there. To blacklist a request, for example, in a filter in a web application or something like that. That's a perfect use case for a set. The order doesn't matter. Duplicates make no sense. It's stupid to have twice the same IP there. And also, since it's the only thing I'm doing is checking if something is part of that list, and I'm doing it for every request in my web application, for example. Yeah. It being fast, it's very nice. Converting it to a set is trivial. This uses a set now. Look at the change, it's minimal. other than that, it works the same. But yeah, it's faster. I benchmark it like Eric. If the list is short, the gain is not very big. Still, 3 times faster, not bad. But as the list keeps growing, the performance gain is bigger. That's because the data is laid out in a way that it's optimized to check whether something is included or not. It's the right data structure for that job. Other than that, you can do with a set pretty much everything that you can do with an array. You can combine two or remove things, or more or less the same thing you can do with an array. It's also enumerable, so you can do everything that you can do with an array. But if it's the right use case, it's a really nice tool that you have there. Probably your code bases are full of arrays that want to be set. So you can go find them, and you will already have got something useful for my talk, which would make me very happy. We can continue with the second example. It's called queue. A queue is also a specialized list for a specific use case, but other than that, it's similar to a list. It's something that contains things. The special use case or the special thing about the queue is that only supports adding things to the list from one side and reading them from the other side, while at the same time we remove them. A queue. On top of that, unlike an array, it's thread tape. That's why it's included in the thread library. Depending on the version of Ruby we are using, we need to require it or not. In modern versions, it's required by default, so you don't need to do that. So I'm going to show a use case that I find useful and I find interesting. It's called a thread pool. I'm going to explain how it works and how it's done. Imagine that snippet of code. It would be very easy to imagine because it's something absolutely common in our code bases. We have a list of things, and for each of them, we have to do something. Usually, it's more like this. We have to do something that is slow, and that's a problem. What can we do? A very obvious first approach would be parallelizing the processing, if it's possible. And a very simple way to do that would be a parallel map. There are some languages that support it built-in. It's not the case of Ruby, but it's very easy to implement. It would be like this. For each element on the list, I will spawn a new thread that will do the job, and then I will join them all, that is, wait for them to finish. And that will do the task in parallel, and hopefully it will be faster. But there is another problem here. The list could be very big. For example, it could be a very big file sitting in your computer, or even being read from a network connection, so it could be even infinite. That's an anti-pattern in parallelism, because the benefits of new parallel units of work are decreasing as the size of the list got bigger because of the overhead. And on top of being a theoretical anti-pattern, it just doesn't work. If you have a file with 10 million lines and you try to spawn 10 million threads, that's not going to work. The alternative would be using a thread pool. That sounds like something very sophisticated, but it's a very simple idea. Instead of having a different thread for each item, we are going to have a fixed number of threads doing that job. The idea is that number is fixed, so it won't grow as the list is bigger. So this would be the code, and we would use queue for it. It's a bit complicated, probably the most complicated example I'm showing today. So let's see it slowly, line by line. I set a number of workers. It's an arbitrary number. We could probably fine-tune that later, but the important thing is that it's fixed. No matter how big is the list of items I need to process, there will be only 20 threads. Then we create a queue, an empty queue. That would be like creating an empty array, but it's not an array, it's a queue. Then I will spawn that number of threads, 20, and only 20. That doesn't depend on the size of the list. That's 20 threads. And what each of them will do would be getting items from the queue and processing them. Then after I have spawned those 20 threads, I would get the list and I would put all the items I have in the list, I would put them into the queue. So then the thread, each of the threads would be getting one item one by one and processing it, and getting another one, until they receive a special message, a special item, that it's the end symbol. And when they receive that message, they would stop their work. For that to happen, after I have queued all the items, I would send those special messages. Then I would have to send the same number of workers I have, because I need all of them to stop, and then I just need to wait for the thread. It's a bit complicated example, but still, I explain it in 2 minutes. It's 10 lines, and it's a big improvement over the non-parallel example, because it will be faster, and also over the parallel map, because I have control over the number of threads. This, in spite of being an improvement, has also another problem. We have now independent one producer and a number of workers that work independently, so they can have different speeds. It's for example, possible that the producer sends items faster than the consumers are able to process them. And the consequence of that would be that the items would be accumulating in the queue, waiting for an available worker to process it. So, yeah, that's something that we don't want. The same way we didn't want to spawn one thread per line in our 10 gigabytes file, we also don't want to read the whole file into memory, because the queue is in memory. Fortunately, the fix is very easy. In the same library, there is a variant of the queue called sized queue. You see that that's the only change in the whole example. There is a variant of the queue called sized queue that gets a parameter that it's a size. I also set it arbitrarily to twice as much as the number of workers. That can also probably be fine-tuned, but the important idea is that it's fixed, it's a number, and will never grow over it. When the queue is full, like when there are those many items, this call, the call that puts things into the queue, will be blocking. So they would be only put into the queue as fast as they are being consumed by the workers. So that will fix the problem. The items would be only being sent to the queue as fast as they can be processed. There is a small nice thing with this, that after many years without changes in the queue library, the upcoming Ruby 2.3 comes with a nice addition that allows me to make the example a bit simpler. They have added in Ruby 2.3, which will be released shortly and can be already being downloaded to try, which I did for this example. We have the close method that will close the queue. Now we don't need to do that ugly trick with the special symbol to close it. We can close it so the loop is also simpler. When the queue is closed, I won't get any item and the threads will finish. So there are gems for doing background tasks. There are very good gems, like I have a list here, Reske, Sidekick, implementation of the actor model like Celluloid, and they are nice. But if the task at hand is simple, those 15 lines of code might be enough to parallelize that work. So I think it's a useful tool to know. I will go with another example, that it's Rake, and you will say now, hey, Sergio, now you are cheating. You told us you are going to show us hidden things, and everybody knows Rake, and everybody uses Rake because it's very cool, and you are absolutely right. The thing is that Rake, its intended use is to use in the command line, like defining tasks and running them with Rake, and that's very useful, and everybody does that all the time. But on top of that, Rake has a couple of characteristics that made it interesting for this talk. It contains a lot of utilities for managing files and dependencies, because that's what Rake does. And it's part of the standard library since Ruby 1.9. It used to be a gem, but since some years ago, it's part of the standard library. So those two characteristics put together make it a very useful library to use in our programs. I'm going to show a couple of examples of it. Our first example would be this class, FileList. It's a DSL for expressing file name patterns. It's part of Rake library. Rake uses it internally, or even you can use it in your Rake files. And it has a nice API. So for example, you have probably seen or written code like this, which works, and it's OK. It's only a bit ugly, complicated to read, and probably error-prone, because it's a bit complicated. And this DSL file list allows us to write it in a clearer way, I think. It's the same pattern. It's the files in that directory, the files in that directory, that file, but not those files. For example, the DSL has more things. This is just an example. It's a simpler way to create a file list than this. So that's something that you might want to use in your programs. And yeah, you don't need any dependency because Rake is part of the standard library, so you can just use it. Another example of something present in Rake that it's useful for general programs is a feature of Rake that it's timestamp-based file dependencies. Rake is able to decide whether it needs to generate a file or not, depending on its dependencies, and if they didn't change, it doesn't need to generate another file. And we can also do that in our programs with file task, which is another class that Rake uses internally. With that simple example, I'm saying that the file checksum MD5 depend on the file list I defined it before. And I'm saying it how it's generated, and that's it. It will generate that file because I'm invoking the task, but the next time I call this code, if the files didn't change, it won't do anything. This MD5 thing is fast, but if what we are doing there is slow, it's useful not to do it if it's not needed. Now, this program, despite being very short, has a bug, has a problem. If I have a file with a space on its name, it will fail. Because I was naively joining the files together using a space, that won't work. But that lets me introduce another library that is in the standard library and that it's very useful. It's called shellwords. Shellwords contains a series of methods for manipulating strings according to the rules of command line parsing in a shell. So some examples of it. I can split a string using the rules that the shell uses to split them. In that case, yeah, it's the numbers 1, 2, 3, and 31 in Spanish. Some of them contain an space, so I'm quoting it like I would do in a shell. And this split method would be clever enough to know that 31 goes all together, but the rest needs to be split. That's something I find useful, and not having to do that by hand because it's complicated. More examples. We can also escape any string to be sure that it will work in a shell command, because we just saw that quotes have a special meaning in a shell command. So if my file name, for example, has a quote, that will break any command line I generate just putting that string like that. That won't work because it will try to interpret the quote as its special meaning. But I have another method in shellwords that will help me do that, and that will work. That brings us to the last example about shellwords that will allow me to fix the bug in our original program. I have the shell join method, which will join an array of strings or any enumerable of strings, and it will join it not naively like I did with a space, but being clever enough to do it in a way that will work in a command line, so the program is fixed. So if you're writing programs that manipulate files and command lines, the Rake libraries and shell words will be very useful. And this is a very common use case for Ruby as an scripting language. So I hope you find it useful. More useful things I'm trying to teach you today. It's a lot of things, but I will do my best to be short and still show you one more couple of useful things. Can we do the questions at the end? Yeah. Thank you. One more thing. Fiddle. Fiddle is a library that it's part of the Ruby standard library since recently, I'm not sure, 2.0. I'm not exactly sure. Recently, it's there today. And it's used to write native extensions. Native extensions are the kind of libraries that interact with native binary libraries in our system. And that's the kind of task that is scary. It's really scary. I never did it. I don't know if any of you did it. I find it scary. It involves, it's a lot of work. It involves writing a lot of glue code, which is in C. It's generally scary. In fact, not only to write them, it is scary. How many of you have seen a screen like this when trying to install Nokogiri or something like that? That C code needs to be compiled. So even it's even scary just to use it. Fiddle adds a different way to use that native code, which is dynamic linking, and involves far less glue code, but very little code. In addition, mainly, that code is Ruby. So it's not only easier to write, but also there's no compilation step and installation. That's a very big improvement. So for this example, I'm going to show, instead of wrapping an existing library, which would make the example a bit long, because APIs are usually long, I created my own library. It's a very simple one. It basically matches my ability to write C code. In fact, I needed to compile it a couple of times because there was a syntax error. Yeah, this is me writing C. So, what the code does, I can explain it. It gets two numbers, add them together, return it. That's what I can do in C. How do we use that code from Ruby using Fiddle? It's really simple. Provided that the library is already compiled and in my file system, in this file, libmylib.so, I just need to require the library and require that importer module and create a module, extend it with the Fiddle DSL, and then use it to load the library and define the functions I'm using that I will usually be able to just copy from the documentation or the header files. It's that simple. That already works. I can call this, and it will work. Note that Fiddle is doing a lot of things for me. It's doing a lot of mapping with the types. I'm passing normal Ruby numbers, Ruby integers, Fiddle is converting them to C integers to pass it to my library, and it's doing the opposite when getting the result. All transparent for me. This code already works. There is nothing hidden. Now, this library that I just created is not a very Ruby-like interface. It's basically C that can work from Ruby, but it would be considered ugly in Ruby because that's not how interfaces are usually defined in Ruby. So we would usually wrap it a bit more in Ruby code. But once more, this is Ruby code. This is something we can easily do. This is an example that would be a bit more Ruby-like. Here I have my own number class that is able to add it together with another one, and using my library to do the addition. It's a stupid example, obviously, but this is the kind of things you would be doing, trying to hide the fact that it's implemented as a native library. That's what you would be doing, especially when working with pointers. Would keep references hidden in your classes, and use them. This is not different than storing a reference to a Ruby object because it's basically the same. So I find this very useful, not only because you can use binary libraries that already exist, native libraries, but you can also write your own ones in Rust, for example. There is a very nice article describing how to do this with Rust or with Go. I find that something very useful, and you don't need any external dependency in Ruby. It's in the standard library. Last thing in the standard library that I like to show you, because it's not very well known, and I find it very useful. It's called pstore. You might have heard about something called NoSQL. It's kind of trendy. This is from Google Trends. Well, Ruby has had one NoSQL database embedded since the 90s, since the very beginning. It was already there. You probably don't want to base your web service on it because it won't scale, like it used to be said. But if your scripts have moderate persistence needs, I find it very, very useful. I'm using it, for example, for tracking my weight as I try to lose it, and it's working very well together with other things. It features transactions, very fast lookup by key, a flexible schema, and pluggable backends. That sounds like a very good feature list for a NoSQL database. In fact, it's a bit simpler than a NoSQL database. This is how it works. I need to require the library, initialize a store with a file name that will be used for storing the data, and that's all. Then it works pretty much like a hash. I can access it with the square brackets, store things with the square brackets, or with fetch, that does the same, but with a default. That's all. This is how it works. In fact, it doesn't. I said it supports transaction. You need to open a transaction to be able to write to it. So this is how it works. This works for real, and I can read it, and it's there. Transactions are atomic, so you can do the canonical example for a transaction with money in accounts. This is atomic. It's committed at once, so no one will see the intermediate state of the database. I talk about flexible schema because you can store there almost any kind of Ruby object, with the exception of procs. It's the only thing that you cannot store. So I can store a hash. And I can access it like this. All this works. It works. I also talk about pluggable backends. By default, it uses a binary format, which might be not very convenient because it's not very human readable. And on top of that, it changes from Ruby version to another. But it has pluggable backends. The library includes one in YAML. You just initialize it with this other class, and all the examples I showed just work, and they are stored like this, which might be a bit more convenient. On top of that, it's very easy to implement your own backend for this database. This is a JSON one, and it's really simple. You just need to inherit from pstore and implement dump and load, and that's it. You already saw how it works. It reads and writes completely the file for each transaction, so you probably don't want to store a lot of data there. But if your persistent needs are modest, like my example of the weight tracking, it's perfect. You don't need to do serialization by hand, write into a file. This just works, and it's there in the standard library for you to use. This will be the content of that file. So wrapping up, these are just some almost random examples, not random because I looked for them, but there are more. There are more. There are, in spite of being a wasteland with a lot of things that are not in great shape, the Ruby Standard Library is a place where there are things that are useful. So I encourage you to explore it, like I did, and found these five random things. Also, be critical, because as we saw, the shape of this code is not always very good. So sadly, you cannot assume that because it's in the standard library, it's good and it works well, because sadly, it's not like that. But also the opposite. is also not true. So don't believe to everybody that goes around saying it's all shit, don't even touch it, because that's also not true. There are things that are useful. And a last thing, I encourage you to explore it and also share your discoveries with your local community. I think it's important to keep a library alive, that the people know it, uses it, etc. So I encourage you to share your discoveries, writing a blog post, talking to your local Ruby user group, or yeah, or in a nice conference if they let you. Thank you. Yeah, if there is time for, there was at least one question, so. I will repeat the question, but I would first answer, I don't know. I didn't try it. I guess it won't work in some way or another. The question was, how strict is the type checking in Fiddle if I send an argument of the wrong type? I don't know. I didn't try. Probably it's a good idea to do checking of that in your Ruby code before calling the C code. But yeah, as we saw, I think the usual pattern with this would be that your application code don't call the C code directly, but you have some Ruby wrappers that take care of that thing. But yeah, in Ruby, I think that's a big improvement over the having to do it in C. There was another question, I think. There. Yeah, the question, I will repeat it for the video and for the sound, was what's the advantage of using a queue instead of an array? Because you can do the same, add things from one side, taken from the other. The main advantage is that the queue is thread safe, so it's not possible to, in my example, not two workers will get the same item at the same time. Only one. The operation of reading while removing it, it's atomic, so only one worker will get it. Other than that, I would assume that the performance is better because the data structure is specialized, but I didn't benchmark it. The main reason is that it's thread safe.
Thank you. Welcome.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's blocking. It's blocking that thread. That's also different from the array. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, one more.
Yeah, no, that's right. If it was already in memory, it was already in memory. Using the size queue won't remove it from memory. But I would assume that if you are doing something with a big amount of data, you are doing it in such a way that you don't need to have it everything in memory. So, yeah, if you are having 100 items, it's no problem to have them in memory. Even duplicate them again and putting them in the queue would be okay. But if you are, in the example, you are reading a 10 gigabytes file, you would do it in a way that, in fact, you don't need to explicitly define it easily, lazily, because a file handler in Ruby, like file.open whatever, that's enumerable, that doesn't read it. Open it, doesn't read it. And that's enumerable, so you can start iterating over it directly, and it will only read it as. So you don't need to be explicit. That example could work with the list being file. I think I wrote it in one of the examples. Sorry, it was at the very beginning, but yeah, this. If you see this example, that's lazy in that way. It's only reading the file, each line, as for each call to the block. So, yeah, if you put together this example with the Q1, that would be it. You don't need to be explicitly lazy.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Sergio.